Well, I'm sure, pretty sure, that I'm not the only person that this has ever happened to. So if it has happened to you, I will draw comfort from your experience as well. When I was living in South Florida, I dropped a friend off at Miami International Airport when I realized that the gas gauge was dangerously low. The light had come on, and I had to get gas. Now, if you know anything about the area around Miami International Airport, it is not a place where you want to stop and get gas. Getting gas can be the least of your problems. So I expeditiously pay the cashier, I go to put in some money just to get myself home, and a homeless person walks up to me and says, "Do you have $10? Can you spare $10? Well, I would love to tell you that my immediate reaction was, here you go, just pull it out of my pocket and gave it to him. But that wasn't it. My immediate reaction was, no hablo inglés. To which the man replied, oh, que bueno. At this point, I was invested, so I said, excusez-moi, je ne parle espagnol. To which the man replied, incroyable. At that point, I had both run out of languages and excuses, so I handed him some money, and I said it with this, I said, listen, we both know I was trying to get out. But you are trilingual. How is it that you do not have a job? And we began to have a conversation about the situation that he was in and how even though he was learned and educated, it was still difficult for him to find a job. I tell that story because we all have these awkward moments of charity. Somebody comes to us in need, and it isn't always financial need. And we have to decide in that moment, on the spur of the moment, what we're going to do. If we're going to give, or if we're going to not give. And that decision is very crucial, very important to our Christian identity, to our identity as apostles. Today, Jesus relates to us the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. And I want to stress that he doesn't tell this parable to make people with money uncomfortable. Jesus loves everyone. It doesn't matter if somebody has money or not. Jesus loves everybody equally with all of his heart. And he died just the same for the person who has the negative balance in their bank account to the person who is on Wall Street. He died for everyone. But the point that Jesus is making isn't that the rich man is rich. It's that the rich man has lost perspective. If you read closely in the text, it talks about that the man feasted sumptuously every day. Now, when we think of feasting sumptuously, we might think of a Thanksgiving dinner or a Christmas ham. But we're talking several levels above that. We're talking a person who feasted with all types of wonderful things that came from all the corners of the kingdom. And feasted so much that they really lost an appreciation for just how important it is that other people have food as well. The other thing is, it says he did it every day and rested in luxury every day. Well, that's also against God's law because remember, it says that 6 days God labored, on the seventh day he rested. So we're allowed our rest. We're allowed even extravagant rest. But there has to have been some work that we've done during the week to justify our rest. And so the rich man wasn't even doing any of that. But worst of all, just outside his gate is the example of poverty in that time. The man who doesn't just have nothing, he is completely invisible. Because in order for the rich man to get to where he's going, he has to step over Lazarus. And when a person begins to do that again and again and again, their heart starts to grow a little colder and colder and colder, and they begin to notice that poor person less and less. So if you look carefully, the sin that the rich man committed was not being rich. It was that he did nothing. It was the sin of inaction. And that's sometimes hard for us to understand because we think of sin of all the bad stuff that we do. You know, I remember when I was Roman Catholic, I was, 11 years old, and I would go to the confessional, and I'd have to make stuff up. I'd have to make up things that I did to siblings I didn't even have. Because my thought was a sin was something that I did. But sins are also things that we fail to do. And isn't it wonderful that in our own Book of Common Prayer, in the general confession that we say almost every week, because it can be omitted from time to time, what do we say to the most merciful God? We confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Which means all the things we haven't had a chance to do, those moments of charity and love that we saw, but we left undone. And if we know that they're out there, we're going to have to ask ourselves, well, now what do we do about them? How do I deal with that charity that I know that Jesus is calling me to do, but that I'm not sure how to accomplish? Well, I think there's three simple things we have to do in order. The first one is we have to see. It's very easy, especially when we have a routine, to go to certain places. How many people here have taken the same route to church for more than 5 years? Yeah. I mean, I've been doing this with you for a month, and my car could go on autopilot over here. And because we go on autopilot, we miss all the little details in our life about what's going on around us. And worse yet, we could be walking through a neighborhood and not notice the people that we walk by who might be in need. We could also be in the same congregation as people who are suffering and not recognize their need, simply because we're used to seeing them every week. So the first thing we have to do is we have to see what Jesus saw. Jesus was always able to recognize when he was walking around those people who were suffering. And it wasn't just the blind or the leper or the deaf. Those people were very easy to identify. He also identified the people who were broken and sinful. He identified the people who just needed to be touched. That somebody needed to just reach out and give them a hug. So we have to be able to see. And that's going to mean changes as to how we walk around in our daily life. People have become anonymous in our culture, haven't they? We've become numbers and usernames. Whenever I call in to Regions Bank or Chase Bank, they don't want to know my name, they want to know my account number. But we're not a church of numbers. We're a church of souls, of names, of people. So we have to see. The next thing we have to do is feel. We have to let our heart go out to the people we see suffering. And this is very hard, because watching other people suffer hurts us as well. But we look on the news, we see people suffering in the news, especially, for example, we see the pictures of the refugees who wash up on shore that are trying to escape Syria and end up in places like Greece or Italy, and our heart goes out to them, because we know that they're suffering. But it's also easy to become desensitized to that suffering. It's easy to kind of get feeled out. And we can't let that happen. So we have to feel with the people who are in our community, in our congregation, who are suffering. And this one is very easy because Jesus gave us a wonderful example. In the parable of the sheep and the goats in Matthew 25, Jesus turns to the sheep on the right and says, "Come and enter into my kingdom. I was hungry and you gave me to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me a drink. I was unclothed or naked, you gave me clothing. I was in prison or sick, and you visited me." And the people said, "Lord, when did we see all those things that were happening to you and help you?" And he said, "You did it for the least of these, and thus you did it for me." Who among us has never been hungry? Who among us has never wanted to be visited when we were sick? Who among us has never experienced thirst? We all have. And that's where we need to dig from when we're looking how to feel emotionally and let our heart go out to people who are also hurting. Last but not least, the most important thing, we need to do. We need to find a way to do the good that Jesus is calling us to do, even when we're not sure how to go about it. I give the example of what happened to me at the beginning of the story. I'm sure that a situation like that has happened to a lot of us. And what are the thoughts that go into our mind? Should I give that person something or not? What will they use it for? Will they use it for something good or something we know is bad? Well, Jesus tells us to be faithful and to act shrewdly. I know a man that instead of cash, because he never gives out cash, he gives out gift cards to McDonald's and Burger King. Because you can only use it there. And so if somebody walks up to him and says, "Listen, I'm hungry," he gives him a $5 gift card. And he has a conversation with him. Well, one day he was out. He was walking into Panera. And a gentleman said, "Sir, do you have some money for a sandwich?" He reached in and he realized he didn't have it. And he said, "Let's do one better. Why don't you come and sit with me?" They went in, they ordered food together, they sat down, and they exchanged stories. And he realized that this man who was just looking for a sandwich, he was looking for more. He was looking for someone to treat him like a human being. For someone to listen to his story, and it was a great Christian story that he had heard. He said at the end, "I thank you for the food, but I thank you more that you looked me in the eye. We ate together, we broke bread together, and you made me feel like you and I were the same." That was charity. And nothing that day was left undone. Now for some of us, it's easier to do that than others. Our charity may not be monetary. Our charity might be the people that we encounter at work who we know are a little hurt, and maybe we just ask them how their day is instead of scurrying to our office and closing the door. It might be picking up the phone and calling someone who we know hasn't been to church in a while, who might be sick, instead of not. The point is there's a lot of opportunities for us to live into seeing other people, feeling their pain, and doing what we know to be right. The challenge is going to be for us at St. Vincent's in the future is to look around our neighborhood right here and to not just see houses, but to see the people that live in them, the people that drive by our church every day just waiting to be seen, waiting for somebody to feel their pain, waiting for somebody to do what has been left.